All right, we are back with more virtual interviews, and hopefully you all stay tuned for the next 2 hours of exciting folks we're going to talk to, and Jeff's kicking it off. Jeff, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
So for those of you that don't know Jeff, I've talked to him a few times in the past, mm-hmm. and some of the things I think would be fun to talk about for the virtual audience is the things you're involved in. Obviously, big guru around security, so I always like to talk about security with you.
Sure.
You always know what's going on there. And then the Leadership Summit.
Great.
So for the folks that aren't here, Monday through Thursday, Monday, Tuesday is a lot of longer tutorial sessions, which you give some of those. Mm-hmm. Yesterday and today are the concurrent sessions, which are the shorter sessions. You get little snippets of information just to kind of get you excited about a topic, and you can delve in further later. And then what starts tomorrow is the Leadership Summit.
Leadership Summit.
So for the folks out there that haven't heard of that or haven't attended, maybe just give them a little insight into the thought process behind creating that Leadership Summit. Okay. What's the format of it?
Great.
Because it's a pretty cool format.
It is a cool format.
Yeah.
And where it came from was there was a lot of feedback in the STAR conferences that people wanted more around leadership, mm-hmm. more around management. How do I deal with myself as a leader, my
yep.
people? That I have to lead, and my boss that you should be leading, right?
Yeah.
You need to lead in all directions.
Exactly.
And TechWell decided it made sense to start a day just focused on leadership from a
yep.
quality and testing perspective.
Exactly.
And so what we do it at Star East and Star West, is we focus on bringing in a couple of speakers, mm-hmm. senior, veteran, software people, often with a testing background, mm-hmm. software development background, who have been leaders, mm-hmm. to impart their wisdom
yeah.
about leadership and how they've what they've found works.
Yes.
And then that's about half of the day. And the other half of the day we spend in small groups where we're tackling different leadership challenges.
Mm-hmm.
We ask, before we start, everybody to give us their thoughts on what keeps you up at night as
yeah.
a leader.
Yep.
What's most important? And then I take those topics, I figure out which ones are the most requested topics,
mm-hmm.
so the top of mind ones, and we set up tables, and everybody goes to the table they want to talk about, and they problem solve and brainstorm, and myself and the other speakers facilitate those tables,
nice.
And we come up with and leave there with a lot of ideas about how to address those problems.
Mm-hmm.
And all that gets written up for the participants and sent out to them later, so they have a complete catalog of everything that was discussed.
Yeah, I think it's great. And what's nice about that is the folks, as you said, attending tonight at the opening reception mm-hmm. that they attend will be putting together those thoughts around topics that they want,
mm-hmm.
submitting them to you. You'll be, you know, kind of getting the, clustering the ones that are top of mind.
Yes.
And then using those as the table topics. So we've talked about this in the past, the trends, right, on where
mm-hmm.
people's thoughts are going.
Yes.
And, you know, we tend to see some trending. Certain
mm-hmm.
things, I think we've said, always are there.
Right. There's
right.
some topics always there.
We've
always top of mind.
Right. There's always some stuff
yes.
top of mind. And then there's some that rotate in and out.
Yes.
And some new ones come in and other ones come
mm-hmm.
out. Any predictions for what some of the new ones will be
mm-hmm.
and what some of the ones you think are still trending as they're going to be there because they're there year after year?
Yeah, so I'll start with the ones that are always there.
Yeah.
Finding and retaining people is always mm. on the list. How do I keep my people motivated, happy?
Yeah.
How do I find the right people? You know, and how do I do that in the face of maybe my organization doesn't give the care and feeding to my people that I think they need? How do I do that without a lot of budget?
Without
and
a lot
like
of
that,
support for it.
Right?
Yep.
That's always on the list.
Yeah.
In the last 5 years, Agile and dealing with moving to Agile is always on the list. How
yes.
do I, you know, educate my people about Agile, and how do mm-hmm. I coach and mentor them to be Agile, and how do I deal with this kind of move toward Agile is always on the list.
Yep.
Right? So those are two that are always on the list. I bet we'll see and hear something about DevOps this year.
Really?
Maybe, hey, we're starting to move to DevOps. We're trying to understand what that means
yep.
from a philosophy perspective. How does that change anything about
right.
how I manage people, lead people? What does it mean for testers?
Yeah.
We might hear about that.
It hasn't hit the topic yet, huh?
No.
Really? Wow.
Not yet.
That's interesting to me, right? Because from a conference perspective,
it's everywhere.
It's everywhere.
Yeah.
Right? And we've had it for a couple of years.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. I'll be interested to hear if it does hit, because it seems to be everywhere. So it'll be interesting if now the leaders are starting to go, oh, we got to pay attention.
I got to figure out what to do about this.
Yep. Yeah. This is coming.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Any other ones you think might hit that this year?
The only other thing I can think of, obviously, that's hot right now is Internet of Things.
Yes.
And, you know, I don't know how much that's percolated up to, you know, do I need to manage different or lead different if our organization is starting to move toward providing those capabilities, or we're testing those capabilities and I'm trying to understand kind of our role and what we're responsible for and what's in scope and out of scope, and how do I manage and train people around that is something that could pop up.
Yeah. I'll be interested to see if that one pops up too, because there's things people, I think, are just starting to think about. And that's what's kind of interesting about coming to these conferences is you tend to get some of the leading thoughts as well, right?
Right?
So people that are kind of out ahead of it, and it may not be quite mainstream yet. We're talking about it, but everyone's going, oh, that doesn't impact me. It's not touching me yet.
Right.
But one of the things with that is around security, and ties into the other area you spend a lot of time focusing on is around security and security and how do you secure what you have, you know, from for your organizations, protect your data, protect your information, make sure that you're watching out for those things, especially in regulated industries as well, where it's particularly important to do that. I was talking to a gentleman. We were talking about IoT and where it's going, like one example being in the medical industry. So we're seeing today for diabetics, for example, they used to have to prick their fingers, right, all the time to check their blood sugar. Well, now they've got devices that have been approved where it's a patch that you basically wear on your arm. And that patch then can send data and information down to a mobile app.
Right.
And I thought, wow, that's spectacular for a diabetic who no longer has to manually check their insulin level. They're automatically getting notified. It's tracked 24/7. You get more data, right, to trend, which is great. But that data is now readily available because it's going through, you know, through the networks. You now have information out there going down to a mobile app, which then you have access to, but you want your provider or your doctor to have access to, and then who else can get access to it. Great information to have, but now it's out there. That's not, you know, it's probably not super secure information other than they know what your blood sugar is and all that stuff. But what I thought the interesting application of that was, they said, now what about parents who have children who are diabetics? Now the parents get access to that information on their phone. So now parents have availability and readily accessible information at their fingertips,
right?
But then you get into, well, can the parents have access and do they have rights to those records? And what if the children don't want them? They're 18 or 17 or 16. Who can have access? And what level of security do you need to have around getting that access to people and ensuring they should have it? So any thoughts on, that's one example, there's many others, with pacemakers, implanted devices, data that comes from those, people's ability to get and access that data, stop and restart implanted devices. Now you're getting a little more.
You're all over.
No,
it's really, now it's really safety critical.
Now it's safety critical if they can stop your heart, right? So we're getting a lot of technology out there that exists that's like that. Any thoughts from your side around security, what things to think about as we're getting into that, securing the data, who has access to the data, you know, getting started in that arena?
Yeah, so a couple thoughts. I mean, Internet of Things basically just is a supply chain of software and devices relying on other devices, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
And so I always look at, I mean, obviously whoever is interacting with the consumer, the end customer, is obviously the most liable and responsible.
Absolutely.
Right? And so it all starts with them. And what they have to do is really just push back and push down on everything that they buy and use to demand some level of security of what they purchase that goes into their devices. So I see it starting at the consumer and being pushed back down from the person selling those devices to the consumer to everybody in their supply chain that is providing either software or sensors or hardware systems that support that.
Yes.
And they're going to have to set and use standards, security standards, and use security testing guidelines to assure that everything they get is secure.
Mm-hmm.
Because really, they're the ones with the most risk.
Right. That's who you hear about, right? So if there's a fault or a failure, the consumer blames the person closest to them.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, it is they sold the product, so it is their responsibility.
Yeah, and we've seen that in practice, right, with Target Corporation, right? When they had their breach, it wasn't necessarily inside their walls, but it was one of their suppliers who then had an issue which leaked data, which then gets out, but they're held accountable financially as well as, you know, just from a responsibility standpoint.
And if you think about so many people use contractors to build their software or outsourcers or others, or they're buying third-party components, almost every single breach can trace back to people outside of the organization that actually was held responsible for it. So the problem's been around a long time. It's just that Internet of Things is making it real-time and safety critical.
Yep.
And now you have to really care about those things.
Mm-hmm. What would you recommend for testers out there who say, wow, you know, we have this group and they're responsible for it, so I don't really do much with it.
Yeah.
Would you recommend that just about every tester out there at least get some base level of knowledge around awareness of security?
Yes, absolutely. And I taught a security testing tutorial here. I mean, my company, Coveros, does a lot of helping people learn how to be better security testers because, first of all, there's no reason a software tester can't look for some level of security vulnerabilities in their testing. It's not that hard.
No.
And second is, of course, if you can find it earlier and fix it, it's going to save you a lot of downstream trouble. And you don't really want to wait till the end. And so pushing it earlier and getting your developers to understand how to build things to be secure, how to get your testers to learn how to do some security testing is going to significantly decrease your risk. Then you're not relying on the people that show up at the end to pull it out. And it's hard to pull it out at the end. I always say in the tutorial, you know, it's no different than if you wait till the end to do your system testing. If you wait till the end, it's a needle in a haystack to find problems. And it's the same in security. You're not going to find all those vulnerabilities if you're coming at it at the end of the life cycle and you have a fixed amount of time and you're doing some red team or penetration testing. You have to do more.
And usually those issues, I would assume too, you know, they're not simple ones to fix a lot of times, right?
Not.
So if you leave it to the end, it could, one problem could uncover other problems. You know, and it could spiral and you're at the end of this life cycle and now you're all of a sudden holding things up. So, you know, finding that stuff early, you know, injecting some of that security testing earlier in the process is a good thing. We're hearing a lot this conference about, you know, we used to hear test the shifting or shift the testing farther up in the life cycle, shift it left. But that includes, and I think things people are now getting more aware of, not just your traditional forms of testing, but security testing, performance testing.
You need availability,
to move
all that. All your non-functionals are moving earlier.
They're moving earlier.
They have to.
They have to. And that's something that I think we're seeing as a trend of an awareness, which also means testers out there have to have a level of knowledge about some of those things. And not to be overwhelmed by it, because a lot of times people go, oh, security, that's super specialized. I don't know anything about that.
Don't do that.
That's not my deal.
Well, and then the other thing you have to figure out is how can you split the non-functional testing into things that you can do earlier, but then you don't repeat later. It's one of the things I talk about in our DevOps tutorial. We do a lot of DevOps work too, and we're always trying to push assurance earlier. And one of the tricks is don't try to solve the whole problem, right? Load and performance test. You're not going to be able to finish that until you have a production-like environment you can do your final load test on. But that doesn't mean you can't measure the performance of the code as you build it and track that. And if it's starting to get slow, correct it early on instead of waiting till the end to figure that out. You can do the same thing with security, privacy, other things. You can take a piece of it that relates to the software itself, irrespective of its environment, and try to make sure it doesn't get out of control early.
So break it into those smaller components. that you can do earlier on and figure out what that looks like.
Right.
Would you recommend, or is there any recommendation to for getting an awareness of where all the touch points are, right? So really getting for the testers a map of what are you connected to? Who are all those suppliers? What are all the APIs? Where can my stuff potentially go so that you're making sure you cover all of that?
Yeah, so there are some products out there and open source technologies that'll scan your file systems, scan your, spider your website. Even there's, I showed it in the tutorial, the security tutorial, there's a site called Build It. I think it's buildwith.com, buildwith.com. Yeah. And if you just point a URL, it'll dump all the frameworks and things that the website is using. Yeah, you want to know what all that stuff is. And to your point about understanding who your suppliers are, if you're using open source components, which almost everybody is today, there's great tools out there now that'll look at, in a DevOps environment, whether the current version of the frameworks or the libraries you're using have known vulnerabilities in them that have been discovered.
Right.
Because a lot of times developers, they get something to work with, say, you know, struts or something, and it works. They don't upgrade their version of struts because they're worried it'll break something.
Right.
And so that, you know, old component might be in your software for years.
And
meanwhile, vulnerabilities are known and found and patches are done and you never update it. And so you're shipping a product with vulnerable code in it.
Right.
That not only has vulnerable code in it, but it has a map as to what's vulnerable, right?
Because so, it's like
it's
a
public
roadmap
information
for people.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
So all the people that want to do bad stuff know exactly where to go.
Yeah. So you can use these tools like BuildWith and other things. If you're a hacker, that's the first thing they usually do is reconnaissance. They try to figure out what you have and what versions of things you use so they can go look. The easiest thing is go see if there's no vulnerabilities.
Right.
And if there are, you're toast.
Right. So you need to. Do you advocate, you know, understanding the mindset of a hacker, where those guys are going, because go there first, check it out yourself, because they're going
to
go there.
Yeah, talk to your developers, talk to your testers, there's tools to scan, understand what languages are used, what platforms you use, what third-party components, what scripting engines are in your software.
Yep.
I mean, you get, the more of that stuff you understand, the more you'll understand what it is you're going to have to do from a testing perspective to make sure it was done right.
Yep. We are out of time, but I know we just scratched the surface and people are probably like, I want to know what all these tools are. So if people want to contact you to get more information on the tools, Coveros, getting some help with that security testing, getting started, what is the best way to contact you?
You can always go through our website, www.coveros.com, C-O-V-E-R-O-S, or just hit me up on Twitter at Jeffrey E. Payne.
Perfect.
It's the easiest way.
Thanks, Jeff, so much for
Thank
being
you.
Here. I appreciate it.
Thank you.